All right, so I was actually gonna do a totally different video today on laws in Japan, but then I realized A, there's a lot of good content out there for it, and B, none of them really cover the three main points I wanna cover today, which are really simple things that might get you in trouble in Japan. Boy, I really hope that I don't have hay fever. That's a thing that happens, by the way. People who live in Japan long enough who've never had hay fever or allergies before can develop them. And I've been sneezing a lot this year. There's a pigeon coming. It's not pigeon. That's the pigeon. Alright guys, welcome to the video. I'm gonna try and cover a fairly serious topic without making it overly serious. I want to talk about a couple things that you can end up bringing to Japan unsuspectingly, totally normal things that might end up getting you in trouble with the police, detained, or even arrested. I want to start by saying that I am by no means a legal professional, and mostly for that reason, I'm going to encourage you guys to do your own research when it comes to these types of things, but I am going to share anecdotes and stories that will hopefully give a little bit of context to all of this. So I just want to jump right into things. There are three main things that I want to talk about today. So all of this actually started back in the summer when my little brother Alexander came to visit me here in Japan. We were planning on doing some camping and he suggested bringing along walkie-talkies. And my instant reaction was no, don't do it, for one main reason. You see, the walkie-talkies that are used in most countries around the world that use frequency bands like FRS and UHF, and I don't know all the technicalities, but they're not really legal for use here in Japan. There are tons of websites that document all the details, so I won't go super technical, but I will say that it interferes with things like the emergency bands for police and fire trucks and all that. It interferes with television waves and so much more, trains, you name it. I would personally just play on the safe side and probably not bring them. But there are cases of people who have been in Japan who have been caught using these and found themselves in fairly big trouble. One of the most famous cases that I heard, and it's why I told my little brother, like, don't bring them into Japan, just don't bring them, was a case of a bunch of like motorcyclers who came into the country, rented motorcycles, and used their walkie-talkies as they were traveling. And on day two, they were stopped by the police and it became a whole big thing. And because walkie-talkies are such a normal thing back home in most countries, you wouldn't expect to get in trouble for bringing something as simple as a walkie-talkie. Now, I know a lot of people are probably gonna jump in and be like, but there are entire radio shops in Akihabara that sell walkie-talkies and radios and everything like that. And a lot of them run on a different band or you need to be licensed for them. Again, I don't know all the details. I'm not a radio pro, but if you're thinking about bringing walkie-talkies to Japan, do your research or just avoid it altogether. I don't know about you, but I kind of already want to change up the scenery a little bit. All right, that works. Now the second one is gonna apply to a lot less people, but this one was more of a surprise to me than anything. So I was sitting down with a friend and he was talking about how a locksmith buddy of his came in through Haneda Airport like a year or two ago. And this person is a registered locksmith back in the United States, and when they landed in Japan, they had their locksmith's kit, their little tool kit, in their bag. They got held right there at the airport because any lock picking tools are completely and utterly illegal in Japan. Again, I don't know what the licensing and all that is for it. All I know is that you can't have it. One of the reasons that I brought this up is because I was scrolling through Instagram the other day and like this ad for like, you know, lock picking stuff for some like, you know, one of those Chinese cheap sites came up. And I was like, I wonder if they would actually allow me to purchase this. And as I was looking through it, I realized, yeah, actually I could purchase this and ship it to Japan. There's nothing on there that says I can't ship it. And something like that can really throw off an unsuspecting buyer who sees it online and is like, well, you know, international shipping, everything's available nowadays. You end up buying something like that and it turns out that it's not legal, and it's such an unsuspecting thing. It's just, it's a lock picking kit. Again, it's not like the average person is really gonna want a lock picking kit. But I guess the moral of this part of it is that the most tiny unsuspecting thing can end up getting you in a lot more trouble than you would expect and potentially ruin your trip to Japan. Something like walkie-talkies or a lockpicking kit, depending on your country, these may be completely and utterly normal things to have. Change up the angle a little bit. I really like this sakura tree. Anyways, back to the main topic. This next one's gonna be really important to hobbyists and people who are looking for alternative ways just to get around Tokyo or Japan. Surprisingly enough, you may run into trouble using things like rollerblades or skateboards. Let me explain, and I'm gonna try and go as basic as possible. You see, in Japan, roadways are designated for cars and bicycles, and sidewalks, for the most part, are designated for pedestrians and bicycles. There's a lot more detail and technicality in there that I'm just gonna kind of blow over. The main point being, there's no specific designation for something like rollerblades or unicycles, if you're a unicycler for some reason, which is actually really popular in Japan, or skateboards. Now, there is a law that states that these can be used, but they can't be used on major roads. I'm not gonna go deeply into the details of what a major road or frequently used road is, simply because it doesn't really matter. It's like a certain number of cars, bicycles, and pedestrians per hour, but the main point is it's a real gray zone. This, for the most part, is on purpose. A lot of Japanese laws leave a bit of ambiguity or gray zone in there to enable the authorities to interpret and use that law as they see fit based on the situation. Now, as somebody who uses a penny board to get around Tokyo quite often, every now and then the police will stop me and be like, can you get off the board? And I just get off the board and say, yep, sorry, no problem, and make it along my way. Kind of want to change this up again. All right, I'm aware that that's almost no change at all, but I like having this little guy in the shot. Getting back to things, more importantly than just skateboarding and rollerblading and all that, there's one really important one that might actually lead you to breaking the law and getting in a lot of trouble. See, recently I went to Brisbane, Australia, and those little electronic scooters, the little Lime scooters, or you know, they're named differently in every city, are insanely popular. That kind of thing will get you in big trouble in Japan. Like a year or so ago, a company sent me one of those electronic scooters and an electronic skateboard to zip around Tokyo on, and I ended up stopping using it really, really quickly when I found out that you can get in really big trouble for using those. In Japan, any motorized vehicle under 50cc is considered a Genski. It's kind of like a low-powered motor vehicle. If you've seen everybody's favorite Mario Karts that are driving around, those are also classified under the same thing. If you have something that has two wheels, you're legally required to wear a helmet, three or more. I don't think you are. Again, don't quote me on it. And along with this classification comes its own set of rules and laws. For example, you have to have a license plate and a car license at the very least to drive one of these. They can't go on the sidewalks, etc., etc., etc. So if the police were to see you zipping down the road on a motorized scooter or skateboard, you could potentially land yourself in a lot of trouble. Which, going back to the lock picking thing, is one of the tricky parts, because getting these into Japan isn't all that hard. That company sent me an electronic scooter and a motorized skateboard. They had no problem getting it through customs and it went right to my front door. But actually using those on the roads is a totally different situation. Now, those are the big ones, but there are also a slew of minor things that you should watch out for. For example, if you have prescription medications and you're traveling to Japan, make sure A, that your prescription medication is allowed in Japan, because some aren't, and B, whether it's allowed or not, definitely make sure you carry your prescription slip. You can get in trouble for that. Even Tylenol with codeine. Codeine is a no-go in Japan. Other ones that throw a lot of people off: you are legally required to carry either your passport or your residence card in Japan, and not carrying one of these can land you in hot water. But something like this, the police are more often than not pretty kind about it. I actually almost never carry either my passport or my residence card, and in the odd time that I've been asked to show ID, I've shown my driver's license, and they've said, do you have your residence card? And I'm like, I'm at home, and they're like, for future reference, you need to carry that. We could technically go to your home right now just to confirm that you actually have it. We're not going to do that because we can see that you have a Japanese-issued driver's license, but point in case, they're usually pretty nice, and they tend to be more so as long as you are nice and respectful of them. I can't really emphasize that enough. So I know these aren't the big, broad, super applies to everybody in the world information, but I do hope that this video helped you in one way or another. Usually I would say leave questions in the comments below, but more than anything, I encourage you guys to really, really do your own research. There are countless other websites and YouTube videos out there documenting things that can get you in trouble in Japan, but I hadn't actually seen these points covered in any video, so I wanted to share these with you guys today in the hopes that maybe they'll be useful to you. If they were at all, or if you even just enjoyed the video, it would mean the world to me if you would give it some love, and if you would leave me something in the comments below. If you are new to the channel, I would love to have you consider hitting that subscribe button, maybe check out another video or two, and you guys know I will see you again real soon.